Let's start. Today I want to introduce some basic properties of tensors on a manifold and what it is from the geometrical point of view. So I just remind you that next time I will be absent, so next lecture will be in 2 weeks after now. Probably we can find some way to meet later. Yes, maybe twice a week. Okay. So we have manifold. What it is? So I think everybody knows what is manifold. Yes? Yes? Okay. Basically, you can think of it as some many dimensional surface in some high dimensional Euclidean space. Actually, it is true. There is a theorem in Riemannian geometry that states that every smooth compact manifold can be emerged in some Euclidean space of very high dimension. So every manifold, there is some very, very big number n such that it can be emerged there. And actually, it can be emerged with a metric, isometrically in some very high dimensions. What are the tensors? Let's start with basic example. We have a curve, we have some point x0, and of course we have some coordinates. Every manifold, especially compact manifold, are the main object in geometry because it is really hard to control some behavior if your manifold is non-compact. So if you have some infinites, you should control how your tensors, some different functions, should behave at infinity, and it is not very easy in many cases. So mathematicians usually want to make their lives as much easier as they can, so they prefer to consider only compact manifolds. So you have coordinates here. It means that locally every point on your manifold have some neighborhood that is homeomorphic to some ball of dimension n. Yes? So, and your manifold can be covered with finite number of these balls. Yeah? So, if it is compact. In this ball, this is some standard object. You always have some coordinates, and you can imagine that, for example, this concrete point has zero coordinates, but it doesn't matter really. So we have these coordinates of the point that lies on our curve, and we have a tangent vector with coordinates, for example, like this. What next? It is easy to see that locally locally in this coordinate, this curve can be written down as follows. So this curve, at least locally, and we suppose of course that everything is smooth, has the following form. Well, yes, it is easy. It is just, for example, like the first terms in the Taylor expansion. So, imagine, but what is really important? Important thing that you can have different coordinates on your manifold. And you want to study those objects that really are invariant, that depends on your coordinates invariantly. Yes, for example, curvature, yeah? If you have a sphere, you can have a different coordinates on this round sphere. The most famous is spherical coordinates, yes? But they are not unique, these coordinates. You can have a lot of coordinates on the same manifold. What do you want? You want such an object that will behave equivalently in different coordinate systems. For example, curvature. You know that curvature is equal to 1 over r squared. Yes? So this awful blackboard. But when you calculate this object, you use the coordinate system, you calculate this scalar product, first quadratic form, second quadratic form, you have a lot of formulas which depends on angles, yes, on these concrete coordinate systems, system. But in the end, you will get some object that is constant. It is constant on the whole surface, and which is independent on these coordinates. So the important, probably I may say, the important things to study is such objects which are. Which does not depend on this coordinate system. Okay, so this was some words. It means from this formula, it means that x dot at t equals 0 equals to xi. So this velocity in this point, it is equals to xi. But if, for example, we have different coordinate system, for example, z. Z1 is a function of xy, x1 of t, and so on, xn of t. And you can put here index I from 1 to n. So imagine that you have two different coordinate systems and you want to understand how does coordinates of this velocity vector will change from when you go from one coordinate to another. It is easy to understand that then if you calculate this thing, what will you get? So z dot of t at t equals 0, it is actually dz over dt at t equals 0, it is equal to dz over dx I, xi over dt, and all of this at moment t equals 0. So we can put here, for example, J, index J, J, and what we will get. So this is the coordinates of this velocity vector in different coordinate system. Yeah. So the object is a curve, and it has some velocity. It has some speed at this point. But on your manifold, there can be different coordinate systems. And in the second coordinate system, this vector equals to psi tilde, and it is equal to the following thing. So I'll put here partial derivatives because it is easier, it is more familiar notation. And this is at t equals 0, and this is coordinates of the same vector in the old coordinate system. So you see, what is this? This is actually the Jacobi matrix in that links two coordinate system x and z at this point, and you see that the coordinates of the vector in u coordinate system equals to actually all of this is in a point x0. So basically this is a definition of the vectors of the vectors on a manifold. What do I mean? I mean that if so, there is different approaches. Yes, you can define a vector that it is some linear term in the Taylor expansion of a curve. Yeah. So you consider a Taylor expansion of a curve, and you define a vectors that like this linear part in the Taylor expansion. This is one possible way to define what the other vectors. The another approach is to state that if your object in different coordinate system change its coordinates with this formula, then this object is a vector. This is some different definition, but actually they are equivalent because of this simple calculation about these formulas. Okay, so definition or a theorem doesn't matter actually. An object psi it's wet, it's better. It's called a vector when its coordinates in different different coordinate systems satisfy this formula. And of course, here we have summation under the I index. So this is some formal notations that is very useful in tensor calculus. So this is a very simple object, like a speed or velocity vector of a curve. And it should remind you about the formulas that was in the last lecture. I asked a question, what is the bad summand in this? So the good summand had this form, and actually it states that this Christoffel symbols is not a tensor, but it will be next. Okay, so example, the next example, if you have a scalar function on your manifold, we can define this vector called a gradient. The question, will it be the vector or no? Will it be a vector? The gradient of a function, as you usually defined it as a vector, yes? No. Actually, no. So what we should check? We should check if these formulas is true, but it is not. For example, if you consider the different coordinate system Z, what will you get? The df over the dxi equals to df over the dzj multiplied by dz j over the dxi. So, and you see what? You see that the coordinates in this was the coordinates in U coordinate system. So imagine that this is, for example, xi, yeah? So this is xi tilde, because it is with respect with new coordinate system, j. And as actually, we should write j beneath, multiplied by dzj over the dxi. And it is equal to xi I below. You see that these formulas different. They different from each other. So it means actually that the gradient of a function is a covector. So covectors should satisfy the following formula. So if this matrix was, for example, J, yes, so the covectors will satisfy the following formula. Here will be J transposed and inversed over the Xi, or in coordinates what we will have, in coordinates actually we'll have this. So you see that here we have summation over the index J. The summation will be here and here, and in the left hand side we have index I. If these formulas is true, so then our object is called covector. Of course, there is more general definition, and actually covectors they are, I always forgot, the tensors of 0-1 type, and vectors they are tensors of 1-0 type. What can you note here? That for example, for vectors you have this formula, and for the covectors you it is better to write it down. Okay, you have these formulas, for example k and for example l, yes, alpha l. So this is a covectors and this is vectors. Of course here you have a Jacobi matrix, and this, and here you have Jacobi transposed and inversed matrix. What you can and note that if this is true, yes, it can happen that this is true, yes, that the Jacobi matrix is equal to itself transposed and inversed, then covectors and vectors, they are the same, yes. And when can it happen? So when do you have this equality?
When Jacobi matrix is orthogonal.
Yes, so this is actually the definition of orthogonal matrices. What does it mean? Orthogonal matrices is such matrices of M and N such that A transposed, or I can put it here, is equal to identity matrix. You can write it down as I or as E. So this is just identity matrix. You can see that this is the same formulas here, but you should remember that this matrix is a matrix on a manifold, and it is depend on the whole system of coordinates, yes? So in every single point of your manifold the map from one coordinates to another is defined by this matrix, yes, and this matrix is orthogonal in every point. So actually, what does it mean for the whole map from x coordinates to the z coordinates? If in every point the Jacobi matrix is orthogonal, how does these maps are called? This is actually the some partial case.
And also there is a reflection.
Yeah. Also the partial case. Actually, any rotation you can describe as a composition of two reflections. There is some theorem, but it is of course only in small dimensions. Well, in small dimensions it is obvious, and in high dimensional it is really very hard to use this fact. So how does these maps are called? Conjectures.
Conjectures?
Yes, your conjectures, yeah. Of course. Well, rotations, yeah. Shifts, yes, yeah. Reflections. How, what is it, what it, no, not, not affine, this is wrong word. How does this map?
Similarity?
What?
No, similar.
No, not similarity. How does these maps, for example, from Rn to Rn, is called when you have, for example, orthogonal matrix X plus shift B. It can be rotations, it can be reflections, plus, yes, at least. This is isometries. So, and of course, in this case, we don't have any shift because everything is linear, not affine. Affine, this is just when you have the space of dots, not vectors. Here you have only linear transformations, and these linear transformations should be orthogonal. It means that this map from one coordinate system to another coordinate system is isometry. So and then you can identify vectors and covectors, and it doesn't matter where to put the index, up or down. So this is just some more or less standard notations from tensorial calculus. Okay, so this is one. Is two, yes, and what else? So if this is true, when g equals to one or e or anything, so but actually in general, this is a matrix, yes? And in general case, what it is actually? This is a matrix, yes? So this is matrix 2, this identity matrix. You see, for example, if J, imagine that J is just a linear map, and J in matrix form is has this these indices. So this formula will be written down in the following way. So here I must write down this because, well, you see, because why? So, for example, here we have I, and here we have J, also from above, and for example, here we have K, yeah? Because when we transpose, we just, well, you see, we change our indices. So this will be some matrix in coordinates, but actually it's not a linear map. Why? Because we have two indices below, yes? Linear map is when you have one index below and one index above. It means that this is a linear transformation. And actually, if you have one index below and one index above, it means that it is one-one tensor. So here is something that have two indices below, I and K. What it is? What is it? What?
Kronecker symbol.
No, Kronecker symbol is only for isometries. So isometry, you should understand, yes, that isometry, what does it preserve, isometry? Isometry is preserve any metrical structure, yes? So the lengths and the angles is preserved in one tangent plane to another tangent plane, yeah? And when it's not preserved, so what does it mean? It means that your metric actually is not Euclidean, yeah? Because it doesn't, when this does not hold, then you have some distortion in your, you can, for example, multiply by some scalar, yes, in one direction, and in another you can shrink. So actually this is exactly the metric tensor. How can you understand this from what we already discussed earlier? Because, for example, in our surface theory, what was this matrix? Jacobi matrix is what? What it is? We had, for example, vector r that depends on two coordinates, and what we had. So if we would R1 and R2. Yes. So this is, we have two columns and actually three rows. Yes, because R1 and R2, they are three-dimensional vectors. Yeah. And if we would consider this thing, it would what be? It would be R1, R2, R1, R2. Yes? And this is will be just R1, R1, So this is will be exactly the first quadratic form. So this is exactly the first quadratic form, or the scalar product, or the metric tensor, and so on. So if your map from one coordinate system to another is not isometry, then it means that it does not preserve some metrical structure, and this map generates some new metric that is generated by some deformation of your manifold. Okay. Actually, here J is always square matrix. Here J is not square matrix, but it's really you can write down here, for example, what normal M. Yes. Actually, it doesn't. It cannot be calculated as a some vector, as a some partial derivative of something, because this vector depends only on two parameters. Yes, but roughly speaking, you can write down here the third vector, then it will be the 3/3 matrix, and here you will have G11, G12, G21, G22, 0, 0, 0, 0, and 1. So almost the same. What next? Is next. So next I want to prove that that the metric is actually the tensor. Metric. What does it mean? It means that these components of the gram matrix. So we have Gij. Yeah. Usually you write down your metric in the following way. So G squared is equal to Gij dxi dxj. So this is just the components of the gram matrix, and gram matrix it defines the scalar product in every tangent space of your manifold. Yes, and we want to prove that these components form the tensor. By the way, what type this tensor will be type
0, 2,
yes, of type zero two You understand, yes? In general case, it is easy to define PQ type tensor. It means what? That it acts from TM. Let us fix this tangent point P in the power Q. Yes. And it goes to TPM in the power P. So for example, what does it mean? It means that the Riemannian metric is a product of two vectors that goes to real numbers. Yes? So you can see that TPM in the power of zero is just scalars. Yes? So what?
From your previous definition, it would be 2, 0.
No? Just a second. I always. No, I think. So.
Okay. I understood.
So 0 is this 0, yes, P equals 0 here, and it means that, what is that, G on, for example, vector xi and vector eta is a real number, yeah? It means just, this is just a scalar product of two vectors. So you have a map from that goes from two pair of vectors to real numbers. It is just a scalar product. And usually there are different tensors. I think, actually, I don't know very the most famous is the Riemannian curvature tensor. It has type 1,3. So you have three vectors, and the result of tensor acting on these three vectors will be another vector. And I think this is the most complicated one that is actually is used in geometry. Of course, you can. There are different, but actually I don't remember any. No, there is a lot of different tensors in differential geometry. For example, complex structure. What it is? Complex structure is something that rotate your tangent plane by the angle pi over 2. Yes? When you multiply a complex number by I, yes, an imaginary unit, it means simply that you rotate your complex number by this angle pi over 2. It is easy to see that because it is this, yeah. So the same you can imagine in if you have odd dimensional manifold, you can rotate any tangent space by this angle. So it will be some linear map that goes usually. This is also this. This is not Jacobian, but the complex structure. It is well-known notation that goes from from tangent space to tangent space. This is also Z11 tensor. So there are a lot of different tensors, and you can ask some question about them. Okay, let's
do with T from TPMQ to TPMP.
What?
Space, I think.
Yes,
about TP
and HT. TP is just tangent space at point P. Okay? So TM is just a linear bundle. Do you know what is it? Linear bundle, yeah? So I don't want to mention to use these words. Now.
Oh, I understand.
So when you fix a point, you fix a point. You don't move on your manifold. You just move in this tangent space. So when you fix this point, you have only linear structure. There is no smoothness. When you fix this point, then it means that you consider only this fiber over one point at your manifold. And everything is linear, and you can almost forget about smooth structure on your manifold. But when you go from one coordinate system to another, you should remember about that, because there is some Jacobi matrix and so on. So let's make a break. What? It is just simple fact that Riemannian metric is a tensor because of this. We must remember that the length of the curve x x dot dt, this should be invariant. Yes, doesn't matter in what coordinate system you calculate the length of your curve. This is a scalar because it is the length of the curve. It should remains constant independently on a coordinate system in which you calculate this length. So, but this this is what? This is this, then you can see that the coordinates of these two vectors can be written down in some different coordinate system, and here you will get what? No. X I over dz k xi tilde k, yes? Yes, this is the formula for now. Just you should use you can put tilde here instead of here. Of course, it is equivalent. you can name the x coordinate system is old one and z coordinate system is new one. It doesn't matter. What is matter is the vectors, they are tensors of rank 1, 0. And here we will have J over ZL eta tilde L. So, and of course, this will be GIJ over DXI DZL or K DXJ DZL and here XI tilde K eta tilde L. So, and this, of course, will be G K I L tilde. And from these formulas, you can see that Riemannian metric is exactly the tensor of type 02. This is just some simple fact that you get from the fact that scalar product is a bilinear form on the vectors. Vectors are the 1, 0 tensors, and the length of a curve or the scalar product should calculate in the same way in the different coordinate system. So actually, this is formula for tensors of type 02. Equivalently, you can introduce, you can understand how does tensors of type PQ should change when you go from one coordinate system to another. I write it down, but actually this is almost useless information because nobody uses it in practice. So you can consider it as either a statement or a definition. Doesn't matter. T is a PQ type tensor if its components change in following way when you go from one coordinate system to another. T tilde I1 IP J1 JQ DZ I1 DX K1 DZ IP DX KP, then dx j no dx l 1 dz j 1 dx l q dz j q t without tilde and k1 kp l1 lq. Okay, this is the most general formula. It is absolutely unuseful, but still. What should you note? For example, if you have 1-1 tensor, as I mentioned above, for example, complex structure, then you here will have the product of these two matrices. Yes, and actually it won't be so this is, for example, J, and this is J transposed. Yes, so it doesn't cancel each other. Yes, so all these matrices that is written down here, they cannot cancel each other because index is different and so on. Okay, and now at the end of this lecture, I just want to give some notation that is usually not very understandable for students, and it is really hard to teach them to use these symbols and what do they mean usually. For example, let us consider let us use a different way. So if you have a tensor, then its components, for example, I, one, I P, J one, J Q, can be considered in the following way. Yes, but this is coordinates in some basis. Yes, for example, when you have a vector, you can write it down as, for example, VI EI. Yes, just a vector in Rn. Yes, so what will it be here? EI is just yes it is absolutely trivial fact. So if you have coordinates, then your object is a linear combination with some basis with its coordinates. Yes, it is trivial. what should we put here in general way?
Some basis.
Yeah. What basis? Okay, some basis. E1, not 1. EI1, tensor product. Think of this just as a symbol that actually don't have any sense. Just a symbol to just to write down. I2, IP. Then what should I write down? EJ1, but from above. Yeah. EJQ. So this, for example, if you have a vector field, yes. So not a one vector in some linear space Rn, but you have a vector field on your manifold. It means that you have a vector in every tangent space on your manifold. Yes? So vector field Xi have some coordinates Xi I in what basis? What is EI here for vector field? Usually, if you have, for example, coordinate system X, what is EI for this?
Along
xi. Yes, how do you usually write this vector? So this EI, it will be just some very, very small shift along the i's coordinate. Yes? Very, very small shift. But it also will be a vector, yes? Like here, EIT is just a vectors too. VI is just scalars, yeah?
Okay, we are partial.
Yes, exactly. So EI is just partial derivative along VI's coordinate. Yes, and usually to write even shorter, usually it denotes like that, yeah? So this is the basis of all tangent space, yeah? So you have manifold M, and you have a lot of coordinate lines. In each point of your manifold, n, if your manifold has dimension n, n coordinate lines intersect in each point. Yes, in this point we have intersection of these two coordinate lines. For example, in our three-dimensional space, you can imagine like this. Yeah. Okay. And this is, for example, x one equals to constant alpha. This is exactly this coordinate line, yes? For example, this coordinate line, so will be written down as x1 equals to alpha plus epsilon and so on, yeah? This coordinate line will be x2 equals to beta. And when you move along these coordinate lines, along these coordinate lines, x1 doesn't change, but only x2 changes, yes? So this will be d over dx, x2. This will be d over dx1. Yes, but this is true only for two-dimensional. Okay, so this is a very small infinitesimal shift along the ice coordinate. Okay, what is EI from above?
It's dxi.
Yes, differential, yes? So how can you imagine that? Because here, if you consider the EJ, it will be the same as EJ from above, because here in standard RN, this exactly the example I was talking earlier today. Here, the standard Euclidean scalar product, yes, it has unity matrix as a Gram matrix, so you can identify this basis and this basis, yes. So, how do you usually define this basis that is conjugate to that one? Usually you define it in the following way. So, EI EJ equals to, yes, so this is the basis that conjugate to that one. Here, if this the standard basis is this, then they are the same. But it is not true in the general case. What about this? This is the standard scalar product, but in our case you can identify that this is the vector field and this is a functional on it, yes? So linear functional on the vector fields. You can write it down as ij on EJ on EI. Okay, and what are the functionals on that? They're exactly the differentials, yes? So one form. Do you know what is one form? They are exactly the differentials. Any one form. Can be written down as some as a some linear combination of differentials. But what is differentials? Differentials, they're exactly the linear functionals on this one. So you can easily written down, but it will be some formal notation, but still. So it means that the basis of standard differentials of the coordinate functions is conjugate to the basis of the vector fields. this is more or less some notation that is used in Riemannian geometry, and you should just to be aware of this. Okay. So, and usually if you have this, you can, what can you do? So this is the basis of the tangent space, and EJ from above, the basis of cotangent space. Yes, so there is covectors. So there is cotangent space, and the basis here is the differentials. And what can you do? You can put index down or up. So, for example, if you have a 1-1 tensor, it means the index is of following view, then you can multiply this tensor by this metrical tensor, and you will get IL. Yes, summation over the J. So it means that metrical tensor can put your indexes down or up. So here you had 1-1 tensor. By multiplying it on the metric J, you get 0-2 tensor. Okay, and in the end, just also to illustrate some characteristics. For example, what is the dimension of 0-2 tensors? By dimension, I mean the dimension over the ring of all smooth function on M. Do you understand what I mean? I mean that every 0-2 tensor T, it can be written down as a linear combination of some smooth functions. Yes, for example, T I J. But here we have I J. Yes. So this is a scalar functions. There are infinitely many smooth scalar functions. How many linearly independent these pairs?
Depends.
N squared, okay. So this is N squared. What are the most famous subspaces in here? The space of all 0-2 tensors on manifold M. What do I want to hear? I want to hear the following thing. So any tensor can be of this type, can be described or splitted into two summons. For example, the first one S and the second one P. S. So this is zero to tensor, and this is zero to tensor also. It means that S and P, they goes from they map the pair of tangent vectors to the real scalars. What is the most natural way to split any arbitrary tensor of this type on two summons?
Symmetrical.
Yes, symmetric and anti-symmetric. So this I will demand, and this I will demand to that. Yes, so this is the symmetrical part. The symmetrical part of this space, and this is skew symmetric or anti-symmetric. So the symmetric part, this is exactly the scalar products, because if you have any symmetrical, well, not exactly, because in Riemannian geometry the scalar product should be positively defined. But any symmetrical zero to type tensor can be written down in the following way. So it is important, what do I written down here? I wrote nothing, yes? It is important. So here, what is the, how does this object looks like? So for example, I will have here G11 DX1 squared, yes? And then will be, so it is symmetrical part, and it means that dx1 dx2 is equal to dx2 dx1. So there will be 2 g12 dx1 dx2, yes, and so on. And what is P? What is the skew symmetric part of this? How does it called? What are they?
Euclidean geometry made it vector
product. No. Come on. Skew symmetric part. So you should have some map that is anti-symmetrical or skew-symmetrical, and it acts on the pairs of tangent vectors, because it is the functionals, yes? You should put down, if you had two tangent vectors, you put down in this skew-symmetric part and you will get a scalars, yes? But if you change the order of the vectors, you will get the minus scalar. What is it? Yes. Yes. Yes, it is determinant, because when you, and it is two form, because you, when you put vectors, tangent vectors to the two form, you should calculate the determinant of the 2x2 matrix. Yes. So this is this is just two matrices, two forms. P12 dx1 wedge dx2 plus P13 dx1 batch dx3, and so on. So the basis of the skew symmetric part of this 0-2 tensors is just simply this wedge products of the differentials, and any two form can be written down as a linear combination. Of course, this will be functions too, but any two form can be written down in this way. So this is just for you to understand. So when you write down in this way, it means that you deal with metric, yes? So this is not wedge product of dx1 wedge dx1. It is zero, yes? When you consider the wedge product. Actually, you can write down the following, that dxy wedge dxj is 1/2 of dxy tensor product dxj minus dxj tensor dxi. Yes? And this notation dxi dxj is the same but with plus. So this wedge products of differentials forms the skew symmetric part of 0-2 tensors, and this products forms the symmetrical part in the space of these tensors. So this is basically everything what I wanted to tell today. Probably you know that there is very rich algebra that is defined on differential forms. Yes, you can calculate all these integrals, global integrals, because you have differential forms on some submanifolds in your manifold. So there are some Stokes formulas, and so on and so on and so on. But this is just to remind you all this tensor algebra. Okay, I think I'll stop here. So next time I will miss. I hope when I will come back it will be not so cold as today.
How next week, no class?
No lecture. I will be in Kazan. There will be some conference in this university where Lobachevsky, he was a student there in Kazan, and even Lenin. Lobachevsky and Lenin, I think, were students in that university. Where will I go to the conference? So I'd like to see all these great places. Okay, let's stop here.